Dear students, today I will discuss about Young's double slit experiment. This experiment is in your syllabus in the optics. So who was Young? The full name of scientist Young was Thomas Young Ephorus. In 1800, Thomas Young carried out an experiment in which the wavelength of light was demonstrated. So you will know that light has both wave nature and particle nature. So there are some experiments in which you will get the wave nature of light, and in some experiments you will get the particle nature of light. So this experiment in optics demonstrates the wave nature of light. So in Young's double slit experiment, what we need? Firstly, we need a monochromatic light source. So what Young did? Young took a screen with a slit S0. So he took one monochromatic light source, and from that one light source he extracted two monochromatic light sources. Actually, for interference we need at least two light waves to interfere. So for two light waves we need two sources, but Young actually took one source and derived two light waves from that one source. So how to do that? So initially one screen with a slit was placed. So after going through S0 slit, the light fall on a second screen which has two slits S1 and S2 at equal distances from the center. So when light wave falls on S1 and S2, what happens? From S1, a light wave from S1 slit, one light wave emerges, and from S2 slit, one light wave emerges. So now we have two light sources. So that is sufficient for interference. So these two light waves will interfere, and to see towards the interference pattern, we also need a screen. So a screen was placed at a large distance so that we can see the interference pattern. Why the screen was placed at a large distance? That I will discuss later. So how the interference pattern looks? It looks like a combination of alternative bright and dark fringes. So bright band or fringes corresponds to the interference maxima, and the dark band corresponds to interference minima. So firstly we have to know what are the primary conditions to get interference pattern. As I have told, Young had taken a monochromatic light source. So this is one condition. And what is another condition? That the light sources must be coherent. What do we mean by coherent? This means the plane waves, or circularly polarized any waves, any light waves. So the phase difference of between these waves must not change with time. So initially if the two waves have a phase difference phi is equal to pi, after some time also they must have phase difference, same phase difference. So that means the light sources must be coherent, and as I have told previously, the light sources must be monochromatic. Monochromatic means, mono means single. So the light wave must consist of only single wavelength lambda. It should not be a mixture of different wavelengths like white light. So white light is not a monochromatic source. Why? Because white light is mixture of different lights. So we can write down wavelength lambda as 2 pi by k, where k is the wave number. So if we have two sources S1 and S2, from from two slits and they interfere. What we get? We get constructive interference, that means interference maxima, and destructive interference, that is interference minima. Let's say at the center point of the screen P, the both waves interfere constructively. Why? Because the distance of the center point P from S1 and S2 are same. So when the point, when the light travels equal distance from the sources, they interfere constructively. Why? Because particularly in this case, initially at the point S1 and S2, both the lights are at same phase. Why they are at same phase? Because they are created as a secondary light source from the wavefront of the primary light source. What is the wavefront of primary light source? S0. So if S0 is our primary light source and wavefront emerges from it, now S1, S2 both lies on the same wavefront of the light wave. So they act as secondary sources and they are in same phases. So that's why initially light which comes out from S1 and S2, they are at same phase, and after they travel equal distance, they are also at same phase. So at P point, the constructive interference is created. Now at any other arbitrary point P1, if the path difference is such that it is the integer multiple of lambda, then also it is constructive interference. Actually, always same traveling same path is not necessary, but they must interfere in such a way that the maximum overlaps, the maximum of two waves overlap, then only you get constructive interference. And if maximum of one wave interfere with minimum of another wave, the maximum of wave coming from S1 interfere overlap with minimum of the light wave which is coming from S2, then we will get destructive interference at any point. Here in the example, in the picture, you can see at P2 point, one light wave is maximum intensity and another one is minimum. So we get here destructive interference. Now, to exactly find out what is the path difference and at what condition we get maximum and minimum on the screen, so we have to do some mathematics. So for that, we have some basic things to know. Like we have two slits S1 and S2. The distance between S1 and S2 is D. The middle point of the line connecting S1 and S2 is O, which we can take as our origin. Now, if we draw a perpendicular from the point O on the screen, then we get OP. So, P is the center point of the screen. Now, we will look into at some arbitrary point P1 on the screen and we will find out what is the path difference of the two light waves at the point P1. What do you mean by path difference? Path difference is the difference of path traveled by light wave coming from two different light sources. So, S1P1 minus S2P1, or you can say S2P1 minus S1P1 is the path difference between the two light waves coming from the double slits. So how to find out that? Here also we have assumed that the line joining O and P1 makes an angle theta with OP, and the distance OP1 is R, the distance S1P1 is R1, and the distance S2P1 is R2, and S1, S2 is D, as we know. So first we will calculate S1 P1 square. So how to calculate that? To calculate S1 P1 square, we will take the triangle S1OP1, where the we know the three sides S1P1 is R1, S1O is D by 2, and OP1 is equal to R, and the angle S1OP1 is pi by 2 minus theta. Now, if we apply vector addition formula, what we get? We get that S1P1 square, that is R1 square, is equal to R square plus D by 2 square minus D into R into cos pi by 2 minus theta. So, R1 square is equal to R square plus D by 2 whole square minus D into R into sin theta. Now, next we will calculate S2P1 square. For that, we will take the triangle OS2P1. Here also we know the three sides OP1 is R, S2P1 is R2, and OS2 is D by 2. And the angle P1OS2 is pi by 2 plus theta. That is that angle between D by 2 and R is pi by 2 plus theta. So, similarly from vector addition formula, we get R2 square is equal to R square plus D by 2 whole square plus D into R into sin theta. So, what's next? Next, we will calculate R2 square minus R1 square. So, R2 square minus R1 square means S2P1 square minus S1P1 square is equal to 2 into D into R into sin theta. Now, we can write R2 square minus R1 square as R2 minus R1 into R2 minus R2. R2 minus R1 into R2 minus R2 plus R1. Now, if we assume that the screen on which we are watching the interference pattern is at a large distance L compared to D, then the distance between P and P1 becomes very small and R1 and R2 becomes almost equal. So, R1 plus R2 becomes 2R. So, assuming that if we put R2 plus R1 is equal to 2R, what we get? R2 minus R1 becomes 2dr sin theta by 2R is equal to d sin theta. So, we can say that R2 minus R1 is almost equal to d into sin theta. Now, this is nothing but the path difference between the two waves, between the two interfering waves coming from two sources S1 and S2. So, here I have shown the same thing in a zoomed way. So, if we want to know at what condition we get constructive interference and what condition we will get destructive interference, how we will get that? We will get that from the value of this path difference delta. So, when delta is an integer multiple of lambda, as we have discussed previously in the condition of interference, so when delta is integer multiple of lambda, that means the two waves interfere at same phase and then we get constructive interference. So, delta is equal to d sin theta is equal to m lambda, where m is 0, plus minus 1, plus minus 2 and any other integers, all integers is the condition for getting constructive interference. Similarly, when delta is equal to m plus half into lambda, where m is integer, then we get destructive interference. That means when we get integer multiple of lambda by 2, then the two waves interfere or two waves fall on each other in opposite phase. So, when they fall on each other in opposite phase, like maxima and minima, then we get destructive interference. So for constructive interference, if we put m is equal to 0, we get the 0th order central bright fringe that we get on the point P, at the point P on the screen, at the center point P on the screen. For first order maxima, we can put m is equal to plus minus 1. So on the both side of central bright fringe, we get first order maxima, and on the both side we get first order minima. So the interference pattern repeats on the both side of the central bright maxima. So m is nothing but the ordered number. So now we know what is the path difference needed for bright fringe and for dark fringe. So what next? Next we find out the distance of the point P1 from the center P on the screen. So we find out what is the distance of the mth order bright or dark fringe from the central bright fringe. For that, as we have assumed previously that we are taking the screen at a large distance L. What that means? L is very, very greater than D, where D is the distance between the two slits. So in that case, sin theta becomes almost equal to tan theta. That means sin theta becomes y by L, where y is the distance between P and P1. So sin theta is equal to y by L. Now, as we know, for getting bright fringe, we have the condition d sin theta is equal to m lambda. So now we will simply put the value of sin theta, that is y by L, in the equation, and we will get y. So if we put sin theta is equal to y by L in the condition of bright fringe, that is d sin theta is equal to m lambda, what we get? D into y by L is equal to m lambda. That means y is equal to m lambda by t into L. Since it is condition for getting bright fringe, so we will denote y as yb. So yb is equal to m into lambda L by t, where m is the order number, lambda is the wavelength of the monochromatic light wave, capital L is the distance between the slits, center of the slits and the center of the screen, and small d is the distance between two slits. Similarly, if we put sin theta in the condition for dark fringe, that is d sin theta is equal to m plus half lambda, what we get? We get yd is equal to m plus half lambda into L by D. So YD is the distance of the dark fringe from the center of the screen, that is P. So if we want to know the distance of a particular maximum, particular order maximum, say third order maximum, from the center of the screen, we have to use the first equation, YB is equal to M into lambda L by D. If we want to know the distance of the dark fringe from the center, we have to use the second equation, YD is equal to M plus half lambda L by T. Thus, from these two equations, we can find out the position of the bright and dark fringes. So students, tomorrow we will discuss about the intensity of the dark and bright fringes. Till then, thank you. Stay home, stay safe.